Why some say the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Hello there, my name is Dr. Steve Rogers. I am the Director of Research at NASA. And today, I'm going to be talking to you about how our planet is being overpopulated. To put things into perspective, it doesn't really take a scientist to tell you that the planet is actually being overpopulated. 200 years ago, there were less than 1 billion human beings living on Earth. 1 billion. We now have 7 billion humans living on Earth. That's 6.5%. of the total number of humans have ever born, ever. The growth was catastrophic. Between the 19th century to the 20th century, the increase in world population was 3 times greater than the entire previous history of humanity altogether. The world population has quadrupled from the 20th century from 1.5 billion to 6.1 billion people. It took only 14 years from 1999 to today for the global population to increase by 1 billion people. That's at a rate of 1 million people every 4.5 days. Is this rate of growth sustainable? The UN doesn't think so, and their estimates are much more daunting than we originally had thought. The UN stated, "We urgently need to stabilize and reduce human numbers. There's no way that a population of 9 billion, the UN's medium forecast for 2050, can meet its energy needs without unacceptable damage to the planet and a great deal of human misery." This is where space exploration comes into the equation. Since we do have space limitations and resource limitations here on Earth, what do you think would be the most logical thing to do? Expand into space. We need to colonize space. It doesn't have to be a large leap forward. We can start slow. We can start by building orbital settlements around Earth in the beginning, and this is easily feasible, wouldn't require an exorbitant amount of resources and time to build. It's also actually instantly profitable. We already have renewable rockets, reusable systems to build, and a fully functional model, the ISS, to help build these temporary settlements. We can start small and then start to expand big. Or as you guys say, Texas style. We can colonize Mars. SpaceX, a private space company that has built renewable rockets, announced that they will begin missions to Mars by 2020. They had also proposed a Mars interplanetary transport system to take humans to Mars and other planets in our solar system. This also introduces the concept of terraforming. The concept of terraforming is practically engineering a planet, making it hospitable, similar to Earth. The planet that we aim to terraform is Mars, because it actually once had hospitable conditions for life. It contains water and is just barely outside the habitable zone, making it able to sustain life. If a population crisis wasn't enough for you, maybe a mass extinction event is. We all know about the theory of the extinction of the dinosaurs was because of a meteor that hit Earth. That one meteor wiped out most plant and animal species here on Earth. Imagine if that could happen again. Actually, it almost did. On February 2013, a 40 meteor asteroid on the same day, the unexpected explosion over Russia of a meteor occurred. The blast injured over 1,000 people and damaged over 4,000 buildings. Although the damage is quite significant, this was only a small asteroid. The other asteroid was only over 3 times that size and probably 4 times the weight. The 40 meteor asteroid that missed Earth by only 17,000 miles was large enough to have caused catastrophic damage if it had entered the atmosphere. This didn't happen 150 or even 10 years ago, it happened 4 years ago. What if a bigger asteroid hit Earth? The effects would be devastating. To put the damage in a visible scale, the bomb that dropped on Hiroshima in 1945 was a 15 kiloton explosion, and that wasn't even the worst. The blast in 2013 was considered benign in comparison to the Tunguska blast. 1908, a meteor blast happened in Siberia that was estimated to be 10,000 to 50,000 kiloton airburst. What's up with meteors hitting Russia? I don't know, blame Putin. The blast exploded in the Siberian forest and literally flattened several hundred miles of Siberian forest. It made our largest nuclear bombs look like peanuts. And the threat is real. Scientists predict 20 million more asteroids in similar paths headed towards Earth. This significantly increases the possibility of a future airburst that may cause catastrophic damage like the one in Tunguska. Should we play Russian roulette and wait until the right meteor hits Earth, or should we do something about it? That's where the Space Exploration Agency comes in. In 2018, the B612 Foundation plans to launch the world's first privately funded deep space mission, Sentinel, which will use an infrared space telescope to identify threatening objects in deep space. This will be the first step towards helping the planet and protecting from extraterrestrial threats. Not aliens, frankly, but more benign threats like asteroids. Now I'm going to move it over to our other NASA research scientist, Professor Maksud.
Alright, thank you, Dr. Rogers. By now we've heard about the existential threats to humanity if we do not voyage out into space. But what about something more immediate? What about its effects on the economy? Before we can explore space exploration's positive economic effects, we have to first understand a basic principle about economics that will explain what differs third world countries and first world countries: technology. Economists view technological changes as one of the most significant determinants of the shape and direction of the United States economy and any economy in that light. So the solution is, space does exactly that. Space exploration's benefits can be felt economically from the food on your table forecast and to the technologies we all regularly use and enjoy. Starting with educational achievement, space exploration has led to the employment of thousands of highly skilled scientists and engineers. This led to an influx of professionals to the cities that are working on the space program. All the collaborative minds in one space stimulated an expansion of university and graduate programs. We also know that the $25 billion spent on civilian space R&D during the 1959 through 1969 period returned $181 billion through 1987. The ROI is way above 44% according to Chase's research on the subject. That is a direct impact. What about the impact on other industries? Decision making by farmers, businessmen, builders, and other users of weather information results in 44% of estimated potential economic gains or more by the usage of accurate weather forecasts. The immediate economic benefits for expansion of cities and surrounding regions, education, and growth of new industries and scientific fields has been a direct byproduct of space exploration. If the largest technological breakthroughs comes from space, what other technological advantages can we spontaneously discover that will solve most of humanity's pressing issues? When President Kennedy challenged America to land on the moon before 1970, no one said if we do this, then in 40 years, we will be able to purchase laptops, computers, satellite receivers, handheld GPSs, and so much more. But that's what happened. Solving the problems inherent in sending astronauts and satellites into space resulted in new products and capabilities that have transformed our culture and spawned a major segment of the global economy worth trillions of dollars. Space exploration has advanced telecommunications, medical technology, weather forecasting, navigation, television, radio, computing, and many other industries. As a direct result of space exploration, our daily lives has not only been improved, but changed forever. Now let me introduce to you our number one scientist at NASA, Mr. Magdy Maksud.
Thank you, Mayor. Dr. Mayor? Professor Mayor? Professor Mayor Maksud? Okay, thank you. It's a real pleasure. The real reason why we all like space exploration is because it inspires us. The real reason, in our information technology economy, the need for higher skilled jobs is becoming a pressing issue. The demand for engineers, scientists, programmers, and various other knowledge workers is becoming increasingly more important. We need more people to do these jobs, but the question remains, are these people motivated to do the job? That's where space exploration comes into the equation. Space exploration encourages people to pursue careers in these esoteric fields. One cannot help but be inspired by our quest into space and finding ways to become involved. In an article by Nature, a very prestigious scientific journal, noted that 50% of the international renowned scientists who published in their journals during the previous 3 years have been inspired by the Apollo missions to become scientists. 89% of this other scientists also agreed that human spaceflight inspires young generations to study science. Here's a chart showcasing space exploration's impact on educational achievement. The result is clear. Space encourages education, and not only does it encourage it, but it improves it. We now know that exploring space solves mundane pragmatic problems, stimulates economy, saves us from extinction, bestowed upon us a noble cell phone, and cursed us with larger textbooks. But space also solves one of our greatest issues: scarcity of key resources. I'm not talking about food here. I'm talking about the elements that make food, the raw materials. We all know that soil requires certain minerals to work: nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, sulfur, magnesium, calcium, iron, boron, manganese, zinc, molybdenum, copper, and much other ones that I can't even pronounce. An estimate done by David Cohen in his article Earth's Natural Wealth, an audit published in the New Scientific, estimated that key elements needed for modern industry and food production could be exhausted in Earth within the next 50-60 years, which is in agreement with the UN's estimate whenever the population is going to be out of control. The solution seems quite clear. Besides changing farming practices, we need to utilize resources in space to fill the growing disparity in resources to consumption ratio. The only way we can do this is by mining asteroids, and it would open up new untapped resource deposits. According to John S. Lewis in his book Mining the Sky, Untold Riches from the Asteroids, Comets, and Planets, he proposes that the metallic M-type near-Earth asteroid 3554 Amun, I don't know why they call it that, but would be a valuable resource deposit. If mined, it would yield 30 billion tons of metals. And that's just one example. There are hundreds of other locations that we can mine and that it will be incredibly beneficial for humans. One such company that is intaking this endeavor is Planetary Resources, and it's funded by Google's founder, Larry Page, and the chairman of Google, Eric Schmidt. They already plan to build a fuel depot in space by 2020, which is in the next 3 years, by using water from asteroids, splitting into liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen for rocket fuel. At this point, the need to explore space increases with every single day. We need to invest more money into space exploration. We need to improve the space infrastructure, and we need to build cheaper and more efficient rockets, satellites, and technologies in order to bring us there. By voyaging out in the stars again, we will increase our economic prosperity, build new technologies that will change our lives, and advance our academic knowledge, and ultimately allow humans to survive into the next millennia. Voyaging out into space is the only way we can succeed. There. My name is Dr. Steve Rogers. I am the director of scientist Directive, what the hell is it? Okay. Between the scientific community on how the dinosaurs went extinct was through an asteroid or a meteor. infrared space telescope to identify the threatening objects on Earth when we don't have a backboard, mate. What are we supposed to do?
There's so many economic benefits that I cannot possibly write them all in this presentation. The bottom line is that...
Thank you, Dr. Mayor Max. You're professor, right? Professor?
Yeah. Oh!
Somebody! Oh!
He needs some milk!